Hello everybody, Reverend Vicky here from St James's, and welcome to this week's Stay at Home Worship, where we're continuing our Encountering Jesus series. And this week we'll be exploring the encounter that Thomas has with Jesus, and how we have now inherited the phrase, haven't we, of doubting Thomas. We use that phrase of doubting Thomas as a negative thing. But actually, as we explore the story together, maybe Thomas was a person who just had questions, who needed hard evidence, as many of us do today. And that's okay. But as I say, we're going to explore that later on. I know from the messages and emails and calls that I've had that lots of us are missing gathering together as one church. And I hear that, and I miss gathering with everybody too. And maybe you'll have seen from the notices that we're due to review the situation of the church building being closed in a couple of weeks. And we're going to do that as a leadership team and talk about what it would look like, any kind of reopening of the church building whilst keeping everybody safe and all of the social distancing guidance, etc. So, yeah, I'll keep you posted on that. But I found this video, and I'd like to start the service with this as a praise. And some of the really positive things that have come out of this awful pandemic that is across the world. But you'll see what I mean when you watch this next video, as people gather together, so to speak, to worship one God in unity.
Thank you. حسمك
هللويا
في قلوب شاكرة
هللويا في بشان بوجه
هوشانا في الأهالي
Slavimo mi
Aleluja
Radosno srcem svi
Aleluja
Budi slavljeno Bože naš
Osana i nesesi
May the God of love bring us back to himself, forgive us our sins, and assure us of his eternal love. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
It was late that Sunday evening, and the disciples were gathered together behind locked doors because they were afraid of the Jewish authorities. Then Jesus came, stood among them.
Peace be with you.
After saying this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were filled with joy at seeing the Lord. Jesus said to them again,
Peace be with you. As the Father sent me, so I send you.
Then he breathed on them.
receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive people's sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven.
One of the 12 disciples, Thomas, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord."
"Unless I see the scars of the nails in his hands, and put my finger on those scars, and my hand in his side, I will not believe."
A week later, the disciples were together again indoors, and Thomas was with them. The doors were locked, but Jesus came and stood among them.
"Peace be with you. Put your finger here and look at my hands. Then reach out your hand and put it in my side. Stop your doubting and believe."
"My Lord and my God."
"Do you believe because you see me? How happy are those who believe without seeing me?
In his disciples' presence, Jesus performed many other miracles which are not written down in this book. But these have been written in order that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through your faith in him, you may have life.
What we've been exploring over the past few weeks have been life-changing encounters with Jesus. Last week we looked at Mary's moment when she encountered the risen Jesus, which gives us not only hope because of Jesus' resurrection, but also because encounters with Jesus aren't reserved for the time when he walked this earth before his death on the cross. An encounter with Jesus is just as possible now as it was then. And these encounters are life-changing moments, pivotal moments. But maybe some of us don't feel like that. Maybe some of us don't feel that there's either been a life-changing moment or even a slow life-changing journey. Maybe some of us feel that a personal relationship with Jesus is for others, not for me. That it couldn't be possible for someone like me. I don't deserve that. Maybe we feel we've missed out, or maybe we have questions. Well, there's great hope in our encounter today, so please hold on to those thoughts, those questions, as we go back 2,000 years. The disciples are gathered together behind locked doors, bewildered, frightened, frightened for their lives, grieving, confused, maybe numb. They've lost their leader, their teacher, one who has shown them a different way of living their faith. They've seen him tortured and killed, and they don't know what's next. And yet, despite scripture predicting Jesus rising from the dead and Jesus telling them that he will die and rise 3 days later, they don't believe. They don't understand. They haven't seen yet. It's in this place of their Sabbath that they wait. The suffering of Good Friday is only too raw, and they don't yet know the miracle of that first Easter Sunday, so they wait. But they wait in that fearful place. Then early on Sunday morning, the women go to prepare Jesus' body with spices. They think it's over. It's finished. Jesus is finished. And we know that Mary encounters Jesus risen from the dead. Peter and John believe because they saw the linen cloths, but no body. And they tell the other disciples what has happened. And then we're told in this passage that Jesus appears to them. Their waiting is over, all except Thomas, doubting Thomas. Well, I'd like to defend Thomas a bit, as he seems to have been labelled as doubting Thomas, as if that's a really negative thing. But this is Thomas's pivotal moment, his life-changing moment. I think that maybe Thomas might have been a bit of a pessimist. Some people rejoice to see a glass half full, but Thomas sees it as half empty. And his world, understandably, has fallen apart. Thomas sees his master arrested in the Garden of Gethsemane, and he flees for his life. On Good Friday, he watches at a distance as Jesus dies, and Thomas's hope likely dies with him. On Saturday, he's in shock. On Sunday, he doesn't gather with his fellow disciples for an evening meal, and that is when Jesus appears. So imagine the conversation from the other disciples when they next see Thomas. Thomas, we were all in that upper room where we'd been meeting. We'd locked the doors for protection. Yet all of a sudden, Jesus appears. Peace, shalom, he says. Then he shows us his hands. There are jagged holes where the nails have been. But he wasn't weak or sick or dying. He's alive, raised from the dead. I don't believe it, barks Thomas. I don't believe a word of it. You're seeing what you want to see. Jesus is dead. I saw him die, and part of me died with him. But he's dead, and the sooner you accept that fact, the better off you'll be. Give it up. Peter pleads with him, Thomas, I saw him myself. I tell you, he was as real as you are. Thomas is cold, maybe with an edge in his voice that cuts like ice. Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my hand into his side, I will not believe it. Maybe Thomas's emotions cool, and by the next Sunday evening, he is eating with his fellow disciples in the same locked room. And suddenly Jesus stands among them once again and speaks, Shalom, peace be with you. Maybe the blood drains from Thomas's face. Jesus turns to him and speaks plainly, without any hint of sarcasm. Put your finger here. See my hands. And Jesus holds out his scarred hands for him to examine. Maybe Thomas recoils. Not out of fear, really, but maybe from a mixture of amazement and revulsion. Jesus begins to open his outer garment and says, Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe. Thomas is weeping now and then begins to sob out loud. Jesus reaches out and puts a hand on his shoulder. Then Thomas slips to his knees and says in awe, My Lord and my God. Thomas, doubting Thomas, is actually the first disciple to put into words the truth that Jesus is both Lord and God. And to take it one stage further, Jesus is Thomas's Lord and Thomas's God. Doubting Thomas utters the greatest confession of faith recorded anywhere in the Bible. And Jesus replies, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Yet Thomas is labelled this doubter, the sceptic, but he's not rejected by God. He's used by God to take the resurrection story all the way to India. Thomas is an encouragement to us in our doubts and in our questions. It's an encouragement to know that we don't lose our place with God when we doubt or are uncertain or we have questions, because Jesus is willing to come and show us his hands and his sides that we might believe, that we might respond then like Thomas and bow down and cry out, "My Lord and my God." What happens to him? Well, doubting Thomas does not stay a doubter. This is his life-changing moment. When he sees the risen Jesus, all that Jesus has taught over the years now clicks in. And to his death, Thomas is an outspoken advocate for his Lord. I think that Thomas would speak to doubters today, to those of us who have seen our hopes and our dreams destroyed. Doubting Thomas would tell his story of how Jesus' life had intercepted his own in a pivotal moment, a life-changing moment. He would tell us his fears and his doubts, and then maybe with a radiant, joyful face, St. Thomas, the apostle to India, would tell of his joy at seeing and knowing the risen Jesus himself. "My Lord and my God," he would say, "my Lord and my God."
I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy path throughout the universe display. And when I think of God, his son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art. Great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and then proclaim, my God, how great thou art. And then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art.
Let us affirm our faith in Jesus Christ, the Son of God. So let's say together, though he was divine, he did not cling to equality with God, but made himself nothing, taking the form of a slave. He was born in human likeness. He humbled himself and was obedient to death, even death of the cross. Therefore God has raised him on high and given him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow and every voice proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. I hope that over the past few weeks, as we've looked at this series of encountering Jesus, and as I said last week, there are many more to explore, so pick up your Bible and have a look. But I do hope that you've seen that Jesus welcomed all sorts of different people, and they were all in different places and all had different needs. As we've just read our statement of faith together, at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow and every voice proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord. Over these past few weeks, we've seen that Jesus draws into community. It's about inclusion, not exclusion. At the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, because all are welcome. At the beginning of this pandemic, when we went into lockdown, there were many churches who used different media sources to share a song of blessing. And so now we're going to close our service with a whole variety of people, both singing the blessing and also signing the blessing through Makaton. And I pray that this video, for each person watching or listening, will know that they are welcome, that they're included, that they're loved, and that Jesus will meet you at your point of deepest need, and he'll ask you that question: why are you crying? Why? Because he cares and he loves each and every one of us. God bless you. Let's pray together. Loving God, you are such a good Father to us. You provide for us in so many ways. And we're sorry for the times that we haven't had hearts of thankfulness. May you give us hearts of gratitude for each new day with you and all that you give to us. May our lives tell of your goodness to us and your love to us through the sacrifice of your Son for each and every one of us. May you help us to spend more time with you. May you grant us times of quiet and reflection, and give us ears to hear your quiet, still voice amidst the storms of life. Please draw us ever closer to you and help us to not be distracted by busyness, but to make space for you in our lives and in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of justice and peace, your heart breaks over your beautiful creation and the conflict in the world today. We pray for the leaders of the nations, that justice and truth may prevail. May the light of your goodness cast out any darkness in the power play of politics. May you make us peacemakers and bridge builders in our communities, and to always stand for what is just and fair. May you challenge us when we turn our eyes away. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of compassion, your love for humanity was revealed in your beloved Son, whose life began in the poverty of a stable and ended in the pain and isolation of the cross. We hold before you those who are frightened, those who feel lost in this world and feel surrounded by darkness, those who may long for a place of safety. May you draw near to them by your Spirit and bless those who provide them with food or shelter or friendship. Lord, may we help where we see those in need. May we be filled with kindness and compassion for others as you take the scales from our eyes and we see people as you do, Father God. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving God, from your word we know that you healed the sick in mind, body and spirit, and we know that you are still healing and renewing today. And we pause for a moment to remember quietly before you those on our own hearts that need your healing touch today. We pray for those who have lost loved ones recently or for whom this is a time of anniversaries. We thank you that you know them and love them. And we trust you, loving Lord, that you will meet their deepest needs at this time. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we thank you that you are a God of transformation, and for the way that each of our lives can change because of you. May our day-to-day lives tell of who you are to the people that we meet, to our families, our friends, our acquaintances, or to the stranger that we may meet. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Has spoken, I am forgiven. King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my
came the morning that sealed the promise.